because we were talking about the benefits of hunger. The month of Ramadan is the month of hunger, is the month of the zuhad, is the month of those people who are aspiring to become abstinent in this world. This world is not all that there is. There are things beyond this world. No? There are things beyond this world, and this is what the Anbiya came to teach us. So when a person forces himself to abstain from fulfilling the desires of the belly, what happens? There are benefits to it. We've mentioned three of them, and we are mentioning the rest of the 10. So let us please listen and understand what benefits this month give us. Or fulfilling one of the most important obligations of this month is al-ibti'adu al-shurbi wa-ta'am, to stay away from drink and food. Right? This is the simplest understanding of Ramadan. But the understanding of Ramadan doesn't only, is not confined in this. There are more to it. Abstaining from the haram and filling one's hours with the khair, the good, and the obedient acts that our Sharia wants from us. We said riqqatul qalb, the heart changes from stone, it changes to something that absorbs all the khair. And this is one of the benefits of fasting, when a person abstains from filling themselves up with food and drink. It thins the layers over the heart. And the ulama Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he used to say, man shabi'a, whoever is filled, he sleeps a lot. And when he sleeps a lot, the heart becomes tired. So what happens? He can make lots of dhikrullah. He can make lots of dhikrullah, but the benefit of the dhikrullah does not penetrate the heart and then change him. You find many of people say, well, during the month of Ramadan, you know, I haven't changed because the stomach has been filled up too much in the evenings. It has been filled up too much in the evenings and caused him to sleep throughout the day and miss out many dhikrullah, moments of remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, sleep is an ibadah during the month of Ramadan, but the one who engages during the dhikr of Allah, with the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the reading of the Quran, is a better sage of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the one who sleeps during the day. There's a difference, right? So this is what hunger brings to the heart. It causes the dhikr to penetrate the heart, and for the khair and the ibadah to benefit the heart. One of the benefits is inkisal, to humble oneself. Yes, to humble oneself, this is one of the benefits of the month of Ramadan, because we can now relate to the balaya, to the tests and the trials that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed on other people outside this country. If you look at Damascus at the moment, or Syria as a whole, we look at the plea of the people, shelter, hunger, they're calling out for food, for drink, because they want to survive. These are the things that people in other parts of the world are experiencing. We don't see this. Today, when we feel hungry, tomorrow when we feel hungry, and the pains of hunger sets in, and we yearn to eat and we can't wait for iftari time, this is just another day for somebody in Bangladesh. This is just another day for somebody in Burma. Another day for somebody in Syria. This is what they're experiencing every single day. And how many, not communities or societies, but countries as a whole, are suffering because food does not reach them. Or they might be drink water, but the water might be contaminated. Starve yourself or keep or abstain from water for a week and see how ill we become. So it's time to reflect. When the pains of hunger comes in, it is inkisar. It humbles us. It should humble us. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say, La, when all the dunya's treasures were brought to him and said, Ya Rasulullah, take this, this is yours. Indulge in this dunya. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, La bal ajru'u yawman. I will starve myself one day. Wa ashbu'u yawman. And I will eat one day. فَإِذَا جِعْتُ صَبَرْتُ. So if I'm hungry, I will be patient. And I will learn patience through this hunger. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَإِذَا شَبِعْتُ. And if I'm filled up, I will thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does hunger give to us? What does sawm give to us? It gives us one beautiful gift, and that is kasru shahawat. It breaks the desires to fulfill or to commit sins. When a person is in a state of hunger, he would not feel the urge to fulfill his desires. The hunger strikes a barrier between him and committing sins. This is a tried and tested remedy. Now, this is perhaps the most important gift that sawm gives to us. When a person is poorly and the doctor tells him, here's your medicine, and he takes it and he pulls up his nose because the medicine doesn't smell nice, and then he tastes it and he says, this medicine is so bitter, I can't see myself consuming this. But the doctor said, you have to take it anyway, otherwise you'll die. Or the disease will set in, or you might lose a limb. Or you'll become poorly for so long that you regret that you have not taken this medicine. So he takes it anyway. And then it benefits him. And the same we say about sawm. Sawm has that benefit. It is a medicine. And it cures our hearts from longing for ma'asi, for sins. It strikes the barrier between us and fulfilling our desires. And the nafs is that particular being. It encourages, it longs to fulfill its desires. And fulfilling its desires means to commit sins. Inna nafsa la'ammaratun bisu. The nafs is that which continuously over and over commands with sins, with ma'asi. One of the awliya said, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the nafs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told it or asked it, who am I? And the nafs replied, you are my slave and I am your Lord. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then punished it for 1,000 years in intense heat and then took it out. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked it again, who am I? And the nafs replied, it said, or she said, you are my slave and I am your Lord. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punished it once again in intense cold for 1,000 years. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took it out and asked it again, who am I? And she replied, you are my slave and I am your Lord. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him one day of fast. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came back to it and asked it, who am I? And he said, you are my Lord and I am your slave. Because the nafs, when we impose upon it the pains of hunger, the desire to fulfill her desires drops. It automatically starts abstaining from the haram and the makruh. And this is perhaps the greatest benefit of hunger, and what Sawm gives to the Sa'im is to transform and to see that we can move and reach beyond the levels of our human self. Like we said in the beginning of this khutbah, it is during this month that the Sa'im realizes that they can reach the levels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's angelic beings. It's the angelic beings that don't depend on food to please Allah, or drink to please Allah, or the opposite sex to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the sign during the month of Ramadan, he resembles these characteristics of the angels. Their hours are filled up with the dhikr like the angels. They sleep little. They sleep little because they want to fulfill their hours with the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we hope to complete the rest of these 10 benefits. Insha'Allah, the next time we meet, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to inspire us all. Insha'Allah ta'ala, we will insha'Allah ta'ala finish the rest of the 10 benefits of hunger after the Salat al-Taraweeh, insha'Allah ta'ala, here in the mosque, insha'Allah, at the center. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in whose hands lies all tawfiq, to grant us all tawfiq during this month of Ramadan, to make this Ramadan a month that we have increased in ibadah more than we had in our previous month of Ramadan. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to strengthen us in his taqwa and tawakkul upon him and reliance upon him. And he is the one who gives all tawfiq. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.